I'd like to resume now. A couple of brief comments about the negotiation simulation. We have a little among ourselves compared notes here, but I thought it went quite well. There was a lot of preparation that was indicated by the different teams. I think that one issue that could probably have happened in the real world is that since the United States called for this kind of dismantling of the agreement, it would have planted with the other allied countries the specific conditions that it wanted in order to reach a revised agreement. So this would be with the British and the French, the Germans, and the EU at least. Because as I recorded the positions of the different groups, almost everyone came out against the US position, which, you know, was part of something we could anticipate, but it's not something probably that the US would have gone into a negotiation blindsided by. But you want to be as much prepared as possible and try to produce the outcome of the negotiation before you go into the negotiation. So that's a key issue. I think also there were questions whether the Russians and the Chinese might have collaborated more together. There wasn't so much of that evidence in the discussion, but I think in the real world, this would definitely be the case. And given the Russian involvement with the Iranians in Syria, the Russian-Iranian collaboration probably also would be happening in the real world. That was evident in the negotiation. But I think overall, the short notice operation, and I think it was very nice. So today we're going to split our time. Professor Burns is going to be speaking in the second half on some more technical material. I'm going to have one of two sessions with you on North Korea. The first session, which will just go till about 10 minutes of the hour, is background about North Korea. And we may get up to through the framework, I'm not sure. But if not, we'll do that next time. I will reappear to finish up on North Korea next Monday. And then we'll get into the details of what the North Koreans have been doing recently, what the real issues are, what the Trump position is, and so forth. So that's two part of our North Korea. Any questions or issues before we get started? We're also finalizing the logistics for the project presentation, and we'll get back to you with final details on that shortly. So we posted on B-courses, and you have it up there here. First, some historical information about Korea. By the way, the book that you were assigned to look at is quite dated, by Gordon Chang. I don't know if you watch any cable TV. He's on cable TV a lot. He's Korean-American. He knows a lot about the subject. He can be somewhat alarmist. He wrote a book a few years ago called The Coming Collapse of China, which doesn't appear quite as imminent, unless I missed something. But this is Nuclear Showdown, North Korea Takes on the World, and he wrote this in 2006. There is a more recent forward updating it somewhat by him. But if you want a lot of the details of the intricacies of North Korean domestic issues, it's not so much on the technical side, this book would be useful for you to look at. How many of you have been to Korea? How many of you have been to South Korea? Quite a few of you. How many of you have been to North Korea? How many of you have been to the demilitarized zone? So several of you. Okay, good. I've got a couple of anecdotes. Did I give you my anecdote about the demilitarized zone? I'm not sure. I'll repeat it for those of you who missed it. Okay, let's sort of begin from the beginning, but in a brief overview kind of fashion. You know, Korea is a peninsula in Northeast Asia. It's notable for its lack of natural resources. It doesn't have oil, doesn't have uranium, doesn't have great hydropower. It needs other stuff from other folks. It was isolated for centuries for the most part and obtained the name the Hermit Kingdom because of its limited contact with other countries, except for several Japanese invasions. In more recent times, but still quite a while ago, the entire peninsula, so all of what is now North and South Korea, was annexed by Japan after the first Sino-Japanese War in 1910. And from 1910 to 1945, all of Korea was occupied by Japan. This was a very difficult and at times brutal occupation. Had I mentioned my anecdote about the grassy knoll? Maybe not. So I had a chance to visit South Korea in the early 80s, and I was taken around by a government official who at one point took me out to a kind of looked like a park area. There's a lot of grass, no trees actually, just an open field. And he said to me that this was a sort of side visit that we were taking, but he wanted to show me this field because it was extremely meaningful to his family. I wasn't quite sure how that field could be connected to his family, so I asked him to elaborate. And he reminded me that through the work of Christian missionaries, Korea has the largest Christian population in Asia. And something like 25% of the population is Christian. And even during the entire Japanese occupation, Koreans in churches, went to services regularly. And that was the case of his parents after he was born, who went to a Catholic mass in a church right at that field. And he said then what the Koreans later learned was a kind of common Japanese military tactic was they would wait until the troops would wait until the entire church was full. They would board the church from the outside and burn it down. So his parents were killed on that field, on that spot. And this is obviously something he was told, because he was a child. But I mention this because there remains deep animosity, very deep animosity, between Korea, even South Korea, and Japan because of the brutality of the occupation, even though it's been 70 years since World War II. Korea, South Korea and Japan are both democracies. They're both allies of the United States. They're close trading partners. A lot of good has happened in the last 70 years, but the underlying problems go back a long time. And there was never that type of incident with the Chinese in Korea. The Koreans historically have not had a degree of belligerence toward China that they've had toward Japan. This makes life a little complicated in today's situation. I as I mentioned there, the Empire of Japan, you know, which became a fascist regime and went on the march in the 1920s and 30s and into the 40s. They held on to all of Korea until the end of the war. One of the very last moments of the war, I think I mentioned this to you, was that when the U.S. dropped the first atomic bomb on Hiroshima, August 6, 1945, on that day, Soviet Union was neutral toward Japan in the Second World War. It had not fought Japan at all. They'd been fighting Germans, but and Italians, but not the Japanese. On August 8, 1945, when the second bomb was dropped on Nagasaki, they were still neutral. But on August 9th, the Soviet Union declared war on Japan. And one of the things they did was to invade the northern part of the Korean Peninsula. When Japan subsequently surrendered a couple of weeks later, Japan, the Japanese forces were removed from all of Korea. The northern part, north of the 38th parallel, was occupied by Soviet forces, and the southern part was occupied by US forces. And that's the origins of the split between North and South Korea. That's the E. Korea was partitioned at the 38th parallel, the Soviet control of the North, the US initially occupied the South, but in a short time withdrew US forces for the most part. The lack of a U.S.-Soviet agreement on the disposition of Korea led to the establishment of two states. The Democratic People's Republic of Korea, the DPRK, in the north, and the Republic of Korea, commonly called South Korea, in the south. In the north, with Stalin as head of the Soviet Union, he assigned to Kim Il-sung, a young Korean communist who was living in Moscow during the war. He assigned him the task of returning to Korea as the new head of North Korea. He was assigned that position by Stalin. Young Korean communist selected by Stalin, Kim Il-sung. And he ruled from 1948 until he died at age 82 in 1994. So that's, 44 years, 46 years. You call that tenure in academia. He was replaced by his son, Kim Jong-il, who ruled from 1994 to 2011 when he died at age 70. And he was replaced by one of his sons, one of Kim Jong-il's sons, Kim Jong-un, who's the current leader of North Korea, in 2011. And his birth date actually remains a matter of dispute, whether Kim Jong-un was born in 82, 83, or 84. So he was somewhere between 33, 35, 36 years of age, or somewhere in that range. One big asymmetry between Kim Jong-il and Kim Jong-un is that Kim Jong-il was long prepared for the position to replace Kim Il-sung. He was groomed by Kim Il-sung. The party and military leadership knew about him. He held increasingly high-ranking positions in the military. He was expected to replace Kim Il-sung when he died. Kim Jong-un was a bolt out of the blue. He was not known to any of the leadership of North Korea. In a brother, a stepbrother, he was the stepbrother who was killed in the Malaysian airport. But he himself had been somewhat of a bon vivant who went around to casinos and stuff. So it was not clear what would happen when Kim Jong-il died. And I don't think the details of how Kim Jong-un was selected have ever been made public. This is a very tough regime. We use the term Stalinist in the West. That means every facet of human activity of the citizens is controlled by the state. If you want to move from city X to city Y, you've got to get permission from the government. If you want your kids to go to a particular school, you've got to get permission from the government. If you want to change jobs, you've got to get permission from the government. There is no parliament that has any autonomy. The parliament is there to approve the decisions of the Communist Party leadership. There's no press, no independent press. There's no radio, television, newspapers. The internet is blocked, although that's weakening a little bit. The vast majority of North Koreans have no access to anything that you see on the internet. There's a continuing parade of demonstrations and laudatory celebrations of the leader Kim Jong-un. And as in the case of Kim Il-sung and to some degree Kim Jong-il, he is considered a god-like figure or a god. So think of yourself as a small child growing up in that environment. You've never heard or read or spoken to a single human being who ever said anything other than that Kim Jong-un is a god. Kind of gets to be your view as well. So this is tight centralized control of the populace by the military leadership and the Politburo of these the Communist Party of North Korea. A bit of a word by Kim Il-sung, because Kim Il-sung started the nuclear program. Sung obviously had close ties with the Russians dating back to his earlier days. Kim Il-sung was developing more significantly a nuclear capability in 1993 and 94, and that precipitated the start of a negotiation with the US, which became known as the Green Framework, which I'll talk about later. And it was during this negotiation, which was stalled in Geneva, I think I mentioned this in this class, that former President Carter, Jimmy Carter, arranged to meet with Kim Il-sung and then inform the Clinton administration kind of at the last minute that he was going there. I was in the government at the time and working on these issues, and it was a big surprise that Carter was going to meet Kim Il-sung. Historically, you should know that the relations between Clinton and Carter, two Southern governor Democrats, was poor. They did not have a good relationship. So Clinton was not interested in being upstaged by Carter, but he basically, at the last second, agreed that Carter could go to meet with Kim Il-sung. They had some meetings, and then there was a cable, this is a free email, days that Kim Il-sung, according to Carter, had made some changes in his position, and Carter now thought it was possible to reach an agreement with the North on either reprocessing or enrichment activities in North Korea. Carter went home, and right after he returned home, Kimmel's son had a major heart attack and died. And people in the Clinton administration said, we have a new international weapon. We can send President Carter for various reasons. And he did the same job on them that he did on Kimmel's son. It was a bit of a joke. Another feature that's not discussed here is that because Kim Jong-un had no background and no connections with the leadership, he was extremely wary of his vulnerability. And subsequently, since 2011, he has systematically gone through and imprisoned or executed a large number of key military and party leaders who we thought might mount some opposition to him. Particularly noteworthy is his uncle. This would be Kim Jong-il's brother, who was Kim Jong-un's uncle. He had especially close ties with China. It's thought in the West that he was profiting tremendously from Sino-North Korean trade. And it was also alleged that there were units of the North Korean military who reported to him and not up the chain to Kim Jong-un. Kim Jong-un clearly did not view this as helpful. So he arrested his uncle, and his uncle was executed. Initially, the reports came out of South Korea that his uncle was executed by placing him alone in a large stadium and then having 20 dogs that had not eaten enter the stadium and attack the uncle. After which they said the only thing left from the uncle was his watch. The dog had eaten every part of his body. This was later confirmed as not correct. But what was confirmed as correct was that the uncle was executed by Kim Jong-un, under Kim Jong-un's orders, by a firing squad, not using rifles, but artillery shells. So he was blown to smithereens. Sorry to get it. You know, you want to learn about North Korea? This is North Korea. He was blown to smithereens by several artillery shells. The defense minister, not long ago, was arrested for sleeping through a meeting that Kim Jong-un attended at his prison. Several senior military officials have been arrested or executed. A number that's bandied about is 70 or 80 of the top political and military leaders have been dispensed with. And it's thought today that Kim Jong-un has definitely consolidated his power. In fact, when he recently went to China, that just happened a couple of weeks ago on his bulletproof green train, that was the first time he had left North Korea since he's been the head of state. And the dominant explanation in the West is that he hasn't left the country to travel because he's concerned about his vulnerability to be overthrown while he's away. That's why he hasn't traveled. Now, today, some other factual information. The main border that North Korea has is with China, 1,400 kilometers, including the Yalu River, which is a key demarcation line that was critical during the Korean War, which we'll talk about. There's a tiny sliver in the northeast portion of North Korea that borders on Russia. 17 kilometers land, 22 kilometers at sea. those are the only borders, only countries bordering North Korea in the north. China primarily and Russia. In the west and in the east, bodies of water, the Yellow Sea and the Korea Bay in the west, the Sea of Japan in the east, and of course in the south is South Korea. North Korea's population today is 25 million, compared to South Korea's 50 plus million, so it's about half the population of South Korea. The GDP of North Korea is $12 billion. The ROK's is $1.4 trillion. So the ROK's GDP is more than 10 times the GDP of DPRK. You've seen probably photos with South Korea's lit up like a Christmas tree and North Korea's completely dark. So this gives you just a once-over lightly of some historical developments about the evolution of Korea domestically. Any questions or issues or comments here? Now, what about important international developments over the years with North Korea? Probably the most significant initial development was a misstep by Secretary of State Dean Acheson. Dean Acheson was a very distinguished diplomat, one of America's most distinguished diplomats in the post-war period. But in 1950, when Truman was president, a year after the Chinese Communist Revolution was successful, which was 1949, Acheson gave a speech at the press club in Washington, D.C., widely covered speech. As the Cold War was becoming very chilly with the Soviet Union. And he was there spelling out where the U.S. areas of concentration would be and where they wouldn't be, what the priorities would be and what they wouldn't be. And in that speech, in a little noted portion, because it didn't seem to be very significant, Acheson stated that Korea, the whole Korean Peninsula, was outside the U.S. defense perimeter. This was viewed as ho-hum by most of the journalists who covered the speech, but it was not viewed as ho-hum in Pyongyang by Kim Il-sung. And although we don't have a lot of detailed archival information and no interviews and no autobiographies, you know, we don't have a lot of first-hand primary source information, it's widely thought that Acheson's speech conveyed a green light to Kim Il-sung to attack South Korea. We now know that Kim Il-sung did go to both Moscow and Beijing, and he met with Stalin and he met with Mao about the feasibility and desirability of invading South Korea. And they both Moscow and Beijing agreed to give him the green light. After all, this was the overarching goal, which is a unified Korea under a communist regime, just as in the South, it's been a unified Korea under now a democratic regime. South Korea was not democratic at this time. It became democratic later. So in June 1950, there was a sudden North Korean invasion of South Korea, and that initiated the Korean War. Lots of interesting things happened here. And nuclear weapons played a small role here, even from a long time ago. Remember, this is a time where 1950, the US is building up a stockpile of nuclear weapons, and the Soviet Union detonated its first device in 1949. So so it's behind the US. There are no other nuclear weapon states. Kim Il-sung presumably felt it was a relatively low-risk operation about involving the US because Acheson had said it's not part of the defense program, not within the defense program. The US went to the Security Council, the United Nations Security Council, and obtained not some sort of quasi-international declaration of war, but a police action. But this was a, you know, to downplay its international significance, to rebuff the North Korean troops, to get the North Koreans to return to north of the 38th parallel. And this turned out to be a large coalition force. You see in the, if you followed just over the weekend, the US attack in Syria, that Trump got the French and the British. You were looking for international support, which connects to legitimization of the military action, which in international legal terms could be illegal, because you're attacking a sovereign state. Who gives the US the right to attack sovereign states? Nobody gives the US the right. So during the peak of the war lasted 3 years, from June of 1950 to June of 1953, South Korea ultimately marshaled almost 600,000 forces. The US put 300,000 troops, there's a zero missing there, 300,000 troops, the British 14,000, and 14 other states contributed small amounts. That's the Luxembourg, they contributed like 14. The Chinese stayed out initially. The North Koreans invaded with an initial force of 75,000, but ultimately brought in more than 500,000 men. MacArthur, hero of the Second World War, commanded the UN forces. And he wanted the, there was a famous Incheon landing where they end run around the North Korean forces that had invaded the South. The US had an amphibious landing in North Korea. But the precipitous act of the US forces getting close to the Yalu River, that's the Sino-North Korean border, triggered the Chinese intervention in the Korean War against the US. So one other important note is, this is the one and only time that US and Chinese forces have fought since the Second World War. It's in Korean War. And a lot of Americans were killed by North Koreans, a lot of Chinese were killed by Americans. The actual number of U.S. fatalities remains in dispute, between 33 and 54,000. A couple of times in the course of the war, Dulles gave a speech once, the Secretary of State gave a speech in Europe about it. There were a couple of press conferences. The U.S. appeared to imply that we were considering using nuclear weapons to stop the North Koreans and the Chinese from their actions and from taking over any part of South Korea. Some scholars have looked into this, and there is some evidence from some North Korean sources that these threats did not appear to be highly significant in North Korean thinking. What was significant was, in March of 1953, Stalin died suddenly. He had a stroke, he died in Moscow. By the way, there's a new film out. I haven't seen it, it's supposed to be terrific. You know that film? It's called,
Is it the death of Stalin? The death of Stalin.
Is it the death of Stalin, or is it something, not, that's not quite right, I think, is it? It is the death of Stalin? Most people don't know.
Yeah.
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 The death of Stalin. I've heard it's excellent and quite funny. Because the Politburo members, including Khrushchev, stood around and watched him die. They didn't want to have him survive. And later there was an effort, successful effort to kill Beria, who was the KGB head, because they thought he would kill everybody else if they didn't kill him. Anyway, this is only important for our purposes because Stalin was the supporter of Kim Il-sung in the north, going into the south. And Stalin was initially replaced by Malenkov, who thought it was dangerous to precipitate possible war with the US. And it appears that that might have been the primary motivation for the North Koreans to decide not to continue the fight. And after extensive negotiations for 18 months, an armistice was reached. Armistice is a technical term that means ceasefire. It doesn't mean peace treaty. So there's a ceasefire in Korea from 1953 until this afternoon. There's no peace treaty. There's no end of hostilities. It's just, it's like two boxers that are fighting and they take time out in between rounds. This is a 65-year-old rest period. Okay. So armistice, not a peace treaty, signed in 53, 4 months after the death of Stalin. And the ceasefire produced the status quo ante. In other words, the end result was that North Korean forces had to return above the 38th parallel. It's as though the war had never begun. Since that time, the ROK evolved over the next 30 years into a democratic state. It had been an authoritarian state for most of the period before that. By the way, I think you know that the former Korean president, who's the daughter of a former Korean president, was just sentenced to 24 years in life, 24 years in prison, which is essentially, she's in her 60s, so it's like life in prison, former Korean president. So the democracy in Korea is very healthy. It's an extraordinarily stern judgment. And it's, of course, a highly successful capitalist regime, particularly starting in the late 70s. The slope of the curve of the Korean, South Korean GDP is straight up. The other key thing that happened was after the war, the US formed a military alliance with South Korea, which had three main objectives: to contain Soviet influence in the Pacific, that's by containment of Cold War Soviet expansionism, to deter a second North Korean attack on the ROK. We've always kept forces in the South. Today we have 27,000. And they are considered a tripwire. Any attack on South Korea would mean killing American troops. And to restrain any ROK adventurism. If South Korea, which at times has had interest in moving north, we didn't want that either. So these are the main objectives from a US side of the military alliance with South Korea. The US began to deploy so-called tactical nuclear weapons in South Korea starting in 1958. And they stayed there right till the end of the Cold War, right till 1991, peaking at 950 warheads in the 60s. So since that time, there have been no nuclear weapons on South Korean territory, but the US protects the ROK under a nuclear umbrella with U.S. nuclear weapons deployed elsewhere in the Pacific. We have carriers, we have submarines, we have aircraft on Guam. We don't have any nuclear weapons stationed in Japan. The balance of the presentation gets into all the acts of aggression committed by the North Koreans since the end of the Korean War, and then we get into the agreed framework, and then finally into the most recent activities by Kim Jong-un. That'll be next Monday. So I'm going to stop here. Any questions or comments, corrections? This has been useful background information to understand fully what you're dealing with in North Korea. Okay, then I'll turn it over to Professor Brady.
Put this away here. Directly swap from one computer to another.
Okay, great.
Just like it works. So, let me start off by saying how really sad I am that I missed last week. It looked like, I mean, that this was something I was really looking forward to for the entire semester. So it's really sad that I didn't get to be here for this. It was also an interesting experience because I think right when you folks were doing the crisis simulation over here, I was at a meeting at the radiation sensing lab over at Nellis Air Force Base outside of Vegas. And this is where our nation's emergency response teams are work out of. And it was, the substance of the meeting isn't something that I can really go into, but it was kind of interesting to be in that setting, knowing what was going on over here in Berkeley at the same time. I thought that there was an interesting correspondence. It's really quite impressive about the technologies that we've sort of pulled together to be able to deal with non-state actors in terms of nuclear threats that the country faces, which is really a completely different dynamic if you think about it. But it was very impressive. I describe these meetings often as being both depressing and encouraging. The fact that we have these considerations is depressing. What we've managed to develop is encouraging. We really have quite good capabilities. This is not forensics, it's dealing with things, actually. So with that, I realized that I couldn't really wrap up the majority of the material that we cover in this class without spending some time, more than just my initial little scare that we had at the first lecture, talking about weapons effects. So I want to talk about this, and in particular, I want to give you sort of a general sense of weapons as military objects, and then also go in, take a bit of a deeper dive into radiation effects, because it is really important that you understand that going forward, not just with regards to how it relates to nuclear security and policy, but as just being an informed citizenry dealing with issues revolving around radiation. Okay. But first, let's start off with a discussion of weapons. Oh, right. Let's see if I can get this thing to work directly. Yeah. Okay, so the majority of what you've gotten here, this is stuff that I in turn credit from Professor Ben Bever, but I put a lot of my own material in here as well. But most of it comes from this book by Glassstone, and a copy of this is available for you on P-Courses. So if you want to get a nice little short, I'm not going to go in and show the videos here, a couple of nice short videos that that describe nuclear weapons effects. I'd recommend these two here. They're both quite good. One is about Trinity, which was a 20 kiloton fission device, not actually a weapon. It was a device that was the first one that we used. And the next one is a more detailed description of the effects of Castle Bravo. Castle Bravo was the video that I showed here in this class. I used it as a description of what testing really looked like and what we had to do for it. But really, you could also look at it as being sort of the other end of the yield spectrum, a 15 megaton weapon. Now, to be clear, in general, our military does not rely on weapons of this size anymore, okay? These very high yield weapons really were more from an era where our delivery systems were not so accurate, okay? The preferred approach right now, if I can call it in that regard, is to use multiple smaller warheads that are delivered on the same delivery vehicle. Okay, and that gives you more bang for the buck, literally. It has less ancillary issues that you have when you have very large weapons like this. But still, this sort of covers the entire range. So you can look at a general categorization of the physical effects of a nuclear explosion. It's a nice figure that sort of shows all of them. You've got the blast and the shock, thermal radiation, you have an initial nuclear radiation release, and then you have residual nuclear radiation. Now, from a military perspective, it's these top two, the blast and shock and the thermal radiation, that are really what you're after. Remember that first and foremost, a nuclear weapon is a military device, unless it's being used as a weapon of terror. And really, it's these two together that cause the damage that make it militarily effective, not just something with psychological impact, but actually able to influence an outcome of a military exchange. I've included initial nuclear radiation as being a part of that, but it's like a minority stakeholder here. This is the big deal. You have this huge blast and shock, and I'll go over the different components of that and why that's so important, and the thermal radiation effect. So we've done tests in all sorts of locations. I went over these before. There have been air bursts, high altitude bursts, in general over 100,000 feet. Does anybody know what the kind of the general reason is behind, from a military perspective, for doing the high altitude burst? EMP, electromagnetic pulse. This is in a way, you could think of it now as being a real radical game changer. You have a big EMP, you can shut down a lot of your opponent's civilian infrastructure very quickly. And the impacts of things like that could be quite dramatic. There are underwater bursts, which in terms of testing, we really minimize this because they are filled with a horrifically large amount of persistent radiation, which you'd really rather not have. The vast majority of our tests were underground bursts, and of course there are surface bursts. From a military effectiveness standpoint, the surface bursts were slightly above altitude, medium altitude bursts, are the ones that have the biggest impact overall. This is a fireball over a surface, relatively weakly coupled into the ground. Okay. And you'll see why that's the case. So energy distribution. First component is thermal radiation, and this includes light. And these are very rough numbers. You can tinker with these numbers a bit by changing the characteristics of the weapon, but really you can't tinker very much. At the end of the day, you're releasing nuclear energy, and the primary result, whether you have a fission reaction or a fusion reaction, you start off with a small volume containing a very large amount of energy. Nature doesn't like to preserve that situation. Very rapidly, the energy dissipates itself out into a lower density state. Okay, so regardless of the type of weapon that you have, and there were lots of discussions at various points of time in the media about enhanced radiation of weapons, etc. Mostly, you're always going to have this coupling out to fireball and blast impact is the main things. But so the fireball is the thermal radiation. That's about 35%. The blast is a pressure shock wave, which is really tremendous. About half the energy roughly can go into this. It's tough to compress air a great deal. And so, and when you start, I'm going to show later some pictures of contours of where you're at a static 15 psi level from a nuclear weapon. And it's a huge distance. So you end up, it's that static overpressure that can cause a tremendous amount of damage. And then about 15%, maybe you could push it up to around 25% in the form of nuclear radiation, prompt and delayed, okay? And the vast majority of it is relatively prompt. So you can think of it as the nuclear weapon has got a sequence of events that go on. These are all happening at the same time, but they're causally related to one another. The first part in this sequence is the fireball. The fireball starts to form in less than a millionth of a second after the explosion. When it's first formed, it's several tens of millions of degrees. But at this point in time, when you're up at several tens of millions of degrees, okay, remember that that a billion degrees is 86 kilovolts. So if you're at several tens of millions of degrees, you're down by about two orders of magnitude from that. Okay, so what does that mean? You're looking at a volume, the initial fireball formation is roughly the size of the device itself. So when you're talking about this sort of a temperature, it's when the fireball is about the size of the device itself. And you've already seen pictures of what that looks like. Okay, so it's still pretty small. If you were around that and it was right here, okay, for a very short period of time, Sammy and I are both okay, it's right here. And then as it expands very rapidly, that high temperature dissipates. It drops off very, very quickly. And what happens then in the formation of that fireball is that, well, definitely everything in it, when it's at this temperature at several tens of millions of degrees, everything is a plasma. The entire interior of this, all of the electrons have been stripped away. Okay, they're moving freely from the ions themselves. For a one megaton explosion, roughly speaking, it expands out to about 440 feet in a thousandth of a second, about 5,700 feet in 10 seconds. After 1 minute, it's cool and it's no longer visible. It's really amazing how quickly this energy dissipates itself out. It goes from being something that is of order of or higher than the core of the sun to being done in terms of radiation in about a minute, okay? Again, because this thing is freely expanded. It's not tamped in any sense. There's no reflection of the energy. It's happened that quickly. The formation of a fireball triggers most of the destructive effects of the nuclear explosion. So think about it. This thing goes from 4,400 feet to 5,700 feet, so more than a mile in 10 seconds. Okay. And what it's doing is it's basically pushing the air around it. That's the real key here. There's two keys here. There's the thermal blast itself, okay, which is moving out at light speed. And then there's this basically a wall of air that's being pushed out in front of the shock wave. And that's what we call a static overpressure wave. So in that vicinity, you could have upwards of half an atmosphere additional pressure introduced. And most of you know that right now we live in one atmosphere's pressure, and everything is sort of balanced out. You know, you do a small perturbation when your diaphragm pulls down, and you create a vacuum where air rushes in through your nose. These are very small perturbations. This is a half atmosphere perturbation in a shock wave front going forward, and you'll see how big that is. Okay. So where does the energy, of the fireball come from? What's the original source of the energy for this? Remember, what is the real energy source in the end for most of the yield and most of the weapon? What phenomenon that we talked about earlier?
Fission.
It's mostly fission. This was from lecture 4. This is the distribution of fission energy. Okay. So what's the big source of the energy, actually? It's this, it's the fission fragments themselves. Okay. The fission fragments themselves carry away approximately 80% of the energy of the fission event. OK? Okay, this call comes about from that charge of appropriation. I break the nucleus up. It's got two charge chunks now. They're free to fly apart. That's it. 165 MeV coming out. What is the range of a fission fragment? How far does a fission fragment go before it's stopped? Any idea? This is a very highly charged, very dense little nucleus, okay, that's coming out. About how far? What would stop it? Would I need a car to stop the fission fragment? No? Would I need this? Would this stop a fission fragment? Yeah. Actually, a thick piece of paper will stop a fission fragment. Okay. Fission fragments lose all of their energy over a very short distance. So when you're within the actual pit, the core of the weapon, most of the fission energy is just immediately liberated right there. So the stopping power of that metal is thick, is high enough that it immediately renders up all that energy. Now, what is actually happening is that these dense, relatively massive fission fragments are moving forward into the metal, and they're colliding with a bunch of other electrons in the metal, and that slows it down really rapidly in a very short distance. Okay, so it, literally, when the blast is relatively small, it's lost all memory of its nuclear origins. At this point, it's just a whole bunch of heat energy liberated out. So this is one of those striking stop photography images of the Trinity fireball, and it shows the major components of it. This is the shock front. This was taken at a particular amount of time, something longer than, this is probably at around, here goes, 30 milliseconds. I'm just gonna say tens of milliseconds after the explosion. This is the shock front. This is that spherical expansion, basically driving air out in front of it that comes out as this energy begins to release. Now, Trinity was detonated on a tower. It was a fixed distance over the ground. Okay, that shock wave came down and hit the ground and immediately reflected off of the ground. So now you have an incident wave from the explosion and a scattered wave coming up from the ground. And the two things meet in something that's called the Mach front. Okay. And here in this Mach front, you can see there's a dirt cloud. A lot of dirt's obviously being moved and being moved very quickly. Keep in mind that here's 100 meters. So this is a picture taken 30 milliseconds after explosion. My estimate is that like this is approximately 80 meters high. This is dirt being thrown up 80 meters in less than 30 milliseconds, okay? It gives you a sense of the violence and the force that's involved here in the generation of this Mach front. And that Mach front is very powerful. As that thing moves forward, if it can take literally tons of dirt and just throw it up 8 stories instantly, or 16 stories instantly, okay? What would this do when it hits a building? Okay. That static overpressure is what the military effectiveness of a weapon is based on. Okay. So part two is the radioactive cloud. So during the expansion of the fireball, the vaporized matter really rapidly condenses back again to a cloud containing solid particles of weapon debris. So this is actually a mixture of debris from the actual weapon, its casing, its local environment, okay? Things begin to recrystallize. At first it's all the plasma, then it's all a gas, and then it solidifies back again. And there's a very distinctive pattern that we see in the debris that comes out of this. Very specific shapes of debris that come out. And different materials kind of freeze out from the fireball at different temperatures. We're particularly interested when we're trying to understand a weapon by looking at the debris that comes out of it. We usually focus on the materials that are the most refractory, that freeze out first with the highest temperatures, before the material has gone out and gotten mixed with lots of other debris from the surrounding environment. So the fireball becomes donut shaped with a violent internal circulatory motion, and air is entrained from the bottom. And again, this is because as this shock wave goes out and pushes the atmosphere out around it, what's left behind? What happens when you push all the air out? What's left? A vacuum. So when you think of the typical picture of a mushroom cloud, what you're seeing is that initial push, and then the material gets sucked in from the interior to take up the vacuum that's left behind. Okay. And that's the typical mushroom cloud that we're used to seeing. And this is the source term, basically, for radioactive fallout. So what's the source of the radioactivity itself in the fallout? What is radioactive? So I have fission reactions that have gone on. Maybe I have fusion reactions that have gone on as well. Okay. What are the sources of radiation itself in this thing? What do you think? What is the main source of radioactivity?
Neutron activation.
Neutron activation, that's a good one. That's definitely part of the picture. So to give you an idea, if you approximate it as about 200 MeV per fission, all told, and you've got an average number of fission neutrons coming out of about 2, that roughly speaking, this means that every kiloton gives you about a half a gram of neutrons. Okay? And those neutrons definitely will go out, they will interact with the environment around them, some of them will capture, and they will create radioactivity. That's correct. That's part of it. What else is there? Yes?
The heavy light byproduct of the reaction.
Absolutely. Fission fragments. The fission fragments. Actually, not even just the fission fragments, but the fission fragments themselves are unstable. And they decay and form other unstable nuclei. There's, on average, there's something about like 3 generations of decaying fragments that come out. And that's a very large amount of the activity, absolutely. And in fact, actually what we're doing is we're sort of, if you look at it from a long-term perspective, we're climbing the importance chart. You've got the neutron activation, a big deal. In a weapon that has a high fusion yield, neutrons are a big deal. There's actually a very large neutron signature. But we do not yet have weapons that are free of fission. We need to have fission to set things off initially. And then the decay products from the fragments of fission. What else is there? What other big ingredient is there to fall out? Potentially the most problematic component of it from a long-term perspective.
Getting all the dirt.
So there's dirt. The dirt in and of itself is not radioactive, but some of it is made radioactive by the neutrons. Fortunately, most reactions on things in dirt make only short-lived radioactivity. So the primary interaction, for example, of a high-energy neutron with nitrogen, which is common in both dirt and in air, is to with oxygen nitrogen rather, is to form nitrogen 16, which has a 7-second half-life and decays back down again. So that's not the real problematic thing. I'd almost call that prompt. The real long-term problematic thing isn't that. Yes? Very good. Or Pu-239. There is the real problem. Nuclear weapons are not 100% efficient at burning up their actinide fuel. And in fact, as I talked about in the design components of this, many nuclear weapons have got fission and fusion going on, and then an outer casing of uranium-238, which is very inefficiently fissioned. And so, now U-238 isn't particularly a problem in its own right. If you're worried about that, then worry about burning coal, because that puts much more U-238 out into the environment than nuclear weapons would. But plutonium is a big deal. Plutonium is a 24,000-year half-life. If you burn some small fraction of it, the rest of it is dispersed in the environment. And that's probably the longest-term issue. It has really no military value whatsoever. You could say that the fireball, this is cold and cruel and awful and it churns my stomach to say it, but you could say that the fireball and the explosion, the static overpressure, has value from a military perspective. You might even say from an area denial perspective that fission fragments have a value, because definitely you don't want to march people right through an area immediately afterwards. Okay. But the plutonium, it's just out there. Nothing you can do about it. Okay. Or the U-235, less of an issue because it's a longer half-life and it's less of an environmental impact. But the plutonium is just there for basically forever. A big mess. So here's a picture, a nice picture of a mushroom cloud. You can see what's happening. This is the cool air being drawn up into the hot cloud. I think this picture is a little deceptive, but the reason why it's being drawn up into the hot cloud is because there's actually an under pressure. You've got a vacuum that's happening here. And this is the updraft through the center of the toroid, and that's the shape that you get. And it all arises from the initial cause of this is that big push of air out. That comes out from this. Okay. Part three is the air blast, the shock waves, and thermal radiation, kind of all coming together at once. So for the air blast and the shock wave, the pressure wave develops immediately after the explosion, right? And it moves out from the fireball. It will actually sort of outstrip the fireball. The static pressure wave will outrun it. It's moving at faster than the speed of sound. And it just moves sort of pushing a wave of air in front of it. So after 10 seconds of a 1 megaton explosion, the fireball is 5,700 feet. The distance of the shock front is about 3 miles. So it's moving out ahead of the fireball. And of course, the wave is reflected from the surface. That's that Mach front or Mach wave that I was describing. So what's happening is that it's pressure waves coming from two directions, sort of in front of you or above and below, that smash structures as this thing moves forward. Thermal radiation. So the thermal radiation is re-emitted radiation from the fireball. And it's referred to as secondary thermal radiation, but actually it's probably multi-order radiation. Remember, the fission fragments gave up all of their energy in a really short distance. And now the thing is just continually emitting radiation, hitting other material, absorbing it, re-emitting it. It's high order radiation that's coming out. And eventually, the radiation stabilizes at a temperature that has an energy balance, for those of you who are on the technical side. And then the whole thing is emitting what's called black body radiation. And if that emits very quickly, the power rendered up goes like the temperature of the fourth power. Okay. So the duration is about 10 seconds for a 1 megaton explosion. That's about 99% of the thermal energy. So in practice, what this means is that, what would you see? There is this flash and the emergence of this thermal wave that goes on for 10 seconds. If you're exposed to this directly as a human, regardless of clothing that you're wearing, whatever, you get a huge amount of thermal radiation dumped on you immediately. And as I said, sadly, this basically people burn, okay? So if you are unprotected from the thermal shock, you burst into flame. The outsides of buildings, if they're flammable, will instantly burst into flame, okay? If they're not flammable, obviously, you know, that won't happen. You'll get a puff of smoke that comes out. If you look at the video of Castle Bravo, I did check that one. You can actually see this time-lapse photography. It looks like dust is being blown off of these palm trees. It's not dust. It's literally instantaneous vaporization of the surface of these things. Okay, that's what happens. But then that's over. And what's happening is that, remember that's thermal radiation. It's traveling at the speed of light. That gets to you right away. Right behind it comes the shock wave, okay, which is this static, it both pushes you and it compresses you. That's where you do the most damage to buildings and stuff of that sort, okay. And then lastly, the fireball eventually reaches you, okay. That's the sort of sequence of events if you're at some distance out. So part four is the prompt and delayed radiation or fallout. Okay, so the initial or prompt radiation is defined as the energy that's released within the first minute. So this is mostly neutrons and gamma's directly from the explosion or from the fission products themselves. Okay, this is the direct radiation. And a In terms of damage, this is relatively modest. The gammas themselves are too low in energy to induce radioactivity. Only the neutrons can do that, okay? The primary damage of this isn't this radiation, it's the fact that a large portion of it thermalizes and forms the thermal radiation burst that causes fire. Then there's the delayed nuclear radiation, or what we call fallout. The origin is material lifted into the fireball right after the explosion. It's mixed with radioactive residues of the weapon, activated debris, fission products, and as I said, actually a big consideration if you've got a plutonium weapon in particular is the unspent or the unused fuel itself. And early and delayed fallout depends on the hyperburst, weather conditions, etc. Okay. Once you've moved all this material up into the air, the question is, where does it go? How high did it go? Does it get entrained in other currents, air currents? And that's where you have to start doing rather, it's situational dependence in terms of where that debris goes, okay, and where the fallout would move. So again, going back to the military goals here, most structural damage comes from the static overpressure. And this table sort of lists what a static overpressure in terms of pounds per square inch does to different buildings, to different structures. So light housing gets destroyed by just a 5 psi, 5 pounds per square inch static overpressure. Doesn't sound like very much until you realize how big a house is. If you go to every single part of the house and lean on it with 5 pounds in one direction, a lighthouse will not survive something like that. Wind doesn't tend to do things with quite that force, so it doesn't really take very much. Brick housing, commercial buildings can go up to about 10 psi. Then they too will fail. Reinforced concrete at about 20 psi. Nuclear weapons storage bunkers. This is not actually deep underground facilities, but just the storage bunkers where you would store a nuclear weapon. Somewhere between, so these are really robust structures. If you've ever seen pictures of them, you can Google if you'd like to see them. At the Pantex plant, they look like these little squat, strong concrete structures. At between 100 and 500 PSI, they're knocked out. Command bunkers, depending on the kind of bunker that you're at, somewhere between 100 and 1,000 PSI, they're just cavitated, they're crushed by the overpressure. Missile sites, 500 to 10,000 PSI, truly deep underground facilities like where we have headquarters for our nuclear defense forces are somewhere between 1,000 and 10,000 PSI. So if you want to look at the percentage of population killed as a function of peak overpressure, you can look here. This is a plot from the NRDC in 2001. If you're at greater than 12 PSI, it's going to be fatal. It may not be instantaneously fatal, but you're going to die if you're stuck in a static overpressure of that extent. And you're going to see that if you're actually experiencing a greater than 12 PSI static overpressure, the good news is you won't be around for long because the fireball is going to come in and finish you. Okay. This is a somewhat morbid lecture, but that's the nature of the discussion, the topic matter that we're covering. Some of you may have heard about one of the common terrorist tactics that was in use for some time in Israel was to have a bomber be on a bus and they would detonate an explosive vest. Okay. They could create static overpressures in the bus if the bus's windows were all closed. That was an order of 10 or 12 PSI. And everyone on the bus is dead. It may take a little while, but they're all going to be dead because of the static overpressure. 5 to 12 PSI, it's a mixture of injuries and fatalities. It's somewhere around 2 to 5 PSI. Very few people will die, but there will be injuries. 1 to 2 PSI, again, not so big of an issue here. The question really becomes, at that point, where were you with regard to the fireball and to the thermal radiation blast that would come out? So let's look right around here. This is sort of a military target. If you're wanting to cause tremendous damage, you want to know how far out do I go with somewhere between 10 and 20 PSI static overpressure. Here's a contour, morbidly, actually I'm kind of happy that's not a picture of it on San Francisco, of Manhattan being targeted. Okay, this is the range of 15 PSI static overpressure versus weapons yield. So a small 20 kiloton weapon here, like a Trinity device, kind of one central piece of Manhattan gone. At 200 kilotons, you go out to about 2.7 miles, again with that 15 psi. A 2 megaton weapon, and I should point out that again, this is likely a bit large from what you would expect to see used right now. The most likely thing would be several 400 kiloton weapons at the same time. That gets out, the static overpressure gets out to about 5.7 miles, being at that level that would destroy buildings, almost any building that isn't some sort of a really reinforced concrete battle structure. So that's pretty much all of Manhattan is gone, good chunk of Brooklyn, going up into or at least I should say lower Manhattan is destroyed. So the way you maximize this is you choose the height so that you have the maximum footprint for that static overpressure. Again, if the goal is a military goal, you want to wipe out everything here. The best bet isn't to detonate it directly on the surface because you dissipate a lot of the energy into the ground. You want to detonate it over the surface. You think of it as being land here, and you've got this fireball that's coming out. You want a maximum footprint for that fireball when it impacts on the ground. Obviously, for a larger burst, you get a larger area, and that's what you're seeing out over here. So all of these assume sort of a medium altitude air burst to maximize the damage of that static overpressure. So the thermal wave causes far more damage, and it goes out even farther. So here we are, mass fire goes out to 7 miles distance. And out beyond here still, everything is completely overwhelmed. Now, if you're hitting a military target, the big thing is that if the military is warned, people are going to be sheltered from a lot of this. But if you look back here at these, at the 15 psi overpressure, remember, at 15 psi, you've killed everyone anyway. So unless they're in a pressure-tight reinforced concrete structure, You killed everyone for a 200 kiloton weapon up to 2.7 miles. So it can really rapidly take a set of military emplacements and make them all irrelevant. It erases them right off the bat. Okay. And that's not talking again about the fire damage. So this is sort of I'm sorry, this is such a depressing topic to be going on about. But I felt like if I didn't cover this at some level, it really would, we lose track of the true human cost that's involved in the use of these weapons, what they can do. And I tried to be cold and technical about it here. But you can see the extent of them. Now, in the next part of this, which I'm not gonna go into today because we're at 3:30, I'm gonna start talking about the radiation. But the big thing I want you to get out of it up to this point, everything that comes after this is going to be sort of talking down risks. Really, the truth is radiation is not the big issue with weapons. The big issue with weapons is wholesale destruction in the end of human life. And that's the fireball and the static overpressure and the dynamic shock front moving forward as well. But really, it's those elements of it. So, and they're frighteningly effective at doing this. So on this dour and depressing note, that's it. I'll see you all on Wednesday. Bring your Xanax. Looking forward.